Hey guys, it's Will. Welcome back to the channel. I hope you are doing well. I hope you enjoy this video. It is October. Hell yeah. I love watching horror movies in October. Other than Christmas, or maybe along with Christmas, honestly, I think I like it just as much. This is like my favorite season to get excited about for the calendar in terms of like planning what I'm going to be watching. I started planning my horror watching this year in like August, like 2 months ahead. I was getting way too excited about it. And I started watching horror movies in September. I usually wait until October because I'm like, okay, it's going to be like the perfect season for it. Like, you know, all the Halloween decorations will be up and like blah, blah, blah. I started at the beginning of September. I couldn't help myself. So this video is going to be looking at Halloween, the classic original Halloween film from 1978, and then looking at Friday the 13th from 1980. And it's more about Friday the 13th. And I rewatched both of these movies within like a week or so of one another, like maybe a year or two ago. And I noticed this really, really interesting thing that the first Friday the 13th movie is doing, where it's obviously referencing Halloween and then playing with people's expectations. So specifically, I'm going to be talking about the use of POV camera shots, how Halloween does it, and I'm going to show examples if I have like actual video in this, like video clips to show you, how Halloween does it, what Friday the 13th is doing in reference to Halloween, and then how it starts doing its own thing and messing with your head a little bit, which I think is really, really, really well done, very smart. I love both of these movies. I love both of these series. The Friday the 13th series is one of my main Halloween watches this year. I've been re-going through the entire series. I love it. I got the Shout Factory Blu-ray box set. I'm super stoked about it. So the clips you're going to see in here, I don't know if they'll show up at the exact right resolution because I'm still working out the technology of recording videos for this channel, unfortunately, because this is a big learning experience for me doing these types of videos. But it's from the 4K. It's from a Blu-ray, but it's a 4K remaster of the unrated cut of the film, and then the Halloween is from a recent restoration too, so hopefully the clips look really good here. But I've watched all of the Halloween movies this year, all 13 of them, and I've watched about half of the Friday movies now, and I'm gonna hopefully finish them by the time Halloween officially rolls around. So let's jump into this video and I'll tell you, oh, and to tell you what I'm talking about when I say POV camera shot, just in case anybody out there is unfamiliar, POV stands for point of view. These types of videos are very popular on certain websites within certain genres of entertainment, but basically it's when the camera assumes the point of view of a character. So you're essentially like looking through the eyes of a character. So that's what I mean when I say POV. Let's look at some clips here. So this is the title card from Halloween, which is absolutely classic. So I just wanted to throw that in there to have it there to get us excited to talk about Halloween. So what I'm going to show you here is the very, very opening shot from Halloween. Now this shot is like, I mean, there might be hidden cuts in it, but I think it's like 6 minutes long or something like that. So I'm not going to show the whole thing. We're just going to look at like the first like 50 or so seconds, but just talk about what they're doing in this shot and what makes it interesting as POV. So we get the title card and then we go into the very first shot in the film, which is gay. So Halloween night, 1963. Okay. And then we go into this point of view shot of a house. Okay. So we're looking at this house. And it's obviously a person, right, moving towards this house. And it's unsteady, right? So it makes you like a little bit uncomfortable. It's like, I'm assuming this was Steadicam. This is right around, actually, let me pause it for a second here. I think Steadicam was first used in major movies in like the late 70s. So this being 1978, this was like early in the kind of commercial use of Steadicam, and I think it was a very innovative thing at the time, and it became a big staple of horror within certain kind of subgenres and stuff like that, right? Because it creates uncertainty and uneasiness, because you can't see the character whose eyes you're looking through, so you don't really know who it is, and you know it's a horror movie, and the music and the tone, the ambiance, it's creepy. And this is very kind of voyeur, right? Because of, well, let's keep going and see what we're looking at, but it's a very innovative way to use the camera to unsettle the audience. Like when Halloween came out, you can imagine this would have been very unsettling for the audience because they're only just getting used to, like, I think Rocky uses a lot of Steadicam. And that was like one of the first big movies to use like a lot of Steadicam. And that came out not too long before this film. So it was a relatively new thing. And it's done in such a way that makes you uneasy because you're moving gliding through the perspective of this character. You don't know who they are, but you know it's a horror movie, so you might be like the killer. And then there's this interesting philosophical implication of, like, you know, the perverse kind of, not in like a mean-spirited way, but this kind of playful thing of like the perverse nature of taking joy in the violence and the depravity of horror films. The audience is the POV of the killing and stuff like this. So it's like this thing where you're mirroring the audience's kind of enjoyment of these types of films and like the catharsis they provide and stuff like that. So we're looking at this house and we see some figures through the door, right? And then we move around. Pumpkin, classic, Halloween, love it, hell yeah, very on brand. Okay, now, this is where it gets very voyeuristic. This is these teenagers making out, right? And we're looking through a window at them. We're not supposed to be seeing this, and we know we're not supposed to be seeing this. It's supposed to be a private moment between them. And he puts on the clown mask, and they're, like, goofing around. But they're making out, right? We probably shouldn't be watching this. And they were like, who is this creepy pervert person whose point of view that we're in watching this, right? And then, so this is the title card for the first Friday the 13th movie. So that's the end of that first shot from Halloween. But the takeaways are, right, we open with a title card. We cut to time and place, right? Halloween 1963. Well, I guess the day and time. And then we see that unsettling kind of POV shot. Now, important to keep in mind that Friday the 13th is a movie that is, it's a slasher film. It's an early slasher film. And it is very much in the mold of Halloween. There were slasher films before Halloween. Black Christmas, I think, is often cited as like the first slasher film, which I think was 1974. Halloween was 1978. So it's not the first slasher movie ever made, but it is the movie that blew up the whole slasher genre and made it this huge thing in the United States. And it became a series. And then Friday the 13th films came out, became a big series. 1984, the first Nightmare on Elm Street came out. And that became a series, not really a series of slasher films throughout the 80s, right? And it became this huge subgenre of horror that was kind of like, in a lot of ways, I think probably the dominant commercial genre of horror in the 1980s. And so Friday the 13th is very aware of the fact, as we'll see in a second here, that it is being made in the mold of the Halloween film. But instead of just being like kind of a ripoff in a way, it's this very intelligent, self-aware piece of filmmaking, I believe, that is messing with audience expectations based on the notion that they're expecting certain things because they've seen Halloween and because they're entrenched in certain tropes of the genre that are already emerging, which this movie is playing with. Now, let's look at that. So we open with the title card, okay? And then we get, oh, Camp Crystal Lake, 1958. So we get a title card with the year and with, instead of Halloween, Camp Crystal Lake. But like, this movie is very clearly like having a dialogue with Halloween. Like, you liked Halloween, you're gonna like this movie, but we're gonna mess with your expectations a little bit. Now, there are a couple establishing shots between this shot and the Steadicam shot that we're gonna get into, or the POV shot, I guess I should say. But suffice it to say, we're gonna kind of, the main chunk of the opening here is a POV shot, right? Unsteady, kind of shake, like uncomfortable gliding camera, voyeuristic creepiness. So this is actually even creepier, I think, in a way than Halloween, because you're watching children sleep. I put an edit in there. This is there's a lot of like kind of continuous camera here, but I wanted to get to a couple points without showing like minutes and minutes of this film, right? So the character whose point of view that you're in first walks through that cabin and you see children, right? So what, if you've seen Halloween, and there's a little bit of a spoiler here, I'm going to try not to spoil these movies, but if you've seen Halloween, in the opening scene of Halloween, people end up getting killed, right? So if you've seen Halloween, if you're familiar with that film, we start with the same type of setup, and then we get into a Steadicam shot, right? And then we go into children sleeping at this summer camp, and then right away you're like, oh, crap. Oh, don't kill the kids. Oh, no, right? So it's already having this dialogue with Halloween of playing, and again, not everyone who would have seen, obviously, Friday the 13th would have seen Halloween, but Halloween was a huge hit. So horror fans who were really into Halloween, who loved it, who knew it was this really important seminal film, this movie is playing with expectation, right? So now I wanted to include this part because he goes up these stairs. The person whose point of view we are in, I should say, goes up the stairs and he, wink, wink, teenagers making out, right? Okay, just like in Halloween, where you have teenagers making out on the couch. Like, the opening scenes of these films are so, so, so similar. There's no way that it's a mistake, but this movie is not just a trashy ripoff. It's doing very intelligent stuff by playing with your expectations. Excuse me. So let's get into that a little bit. So this comes later in the film. A young woman who's one of the camp counselors, she's probably like somewhere between 18 and 20 or so, has gone into the bathroom. And so we know she's in the bathroom. She's in there alone. It's raining outside. We get this kind of creepy shot. The door is open. If you look, you can see a hand. Do you see there's like a shadow that looks like a hand kind of in the middle of the light in the frame there, right? So this shot, keeping in mind the opening shot of this film, which is that point of view shot, and then I have to spoil something a little bit here, but as in the opening of Halloween, people get killed in the opening of Friday the 13th. So we have established in the language, the cinematic language of this film, that a POV shot, we are looking from the point of view of a killer who is going to murder someone. As we saw in Halloween, as we saw at the beginning of this film, it set you up to believe that this is the language, like the formal language of cinema that we are using when we, the audience, is looking from the point of view of a killer going to murder someone, okay? So we see somebody step in. And then it looks like, right? So because we see those footsteps, right? That's not within POV, right? But the person kind of, where they step into the room merges with the perspective of the camera, right? So it seems as though we have gone into this POV perspective. And it looks like we are a person, like the camera is walking through this bathroom looking for this young woman. Right, that seems like, based on the way that the perspective of the person walking merges with this perspective of the camera, and based on what we've seen in the opening scene, it looks as though this is a POV shot. And then we get to the bathroom stall where the young woman is sitting, right? Like, she's peeing or whatever. Maybe she's dropping a deuce. And our expectation is the murderer, whoever it is outside this stall and is going to kill her. Right? So, we cut to inside the stall. Now, this is very, very intelligent editing, right? Because it set us up to believe that this someone has come to kill this woman and they are standing right outside this bathroom stall, that was their point of view. So it's almost like a match cut, right? That was their point of view. Outside the stall, we're cutting to inside the stall opposite their point of view. So they're standing right on the other side of that door, right? Based again on not only Halloween, but what we saw in the opening of this film. So we think this killer is going to be right there on the other side of the bathroom stall. And she thinks something creepy is going on too. But voila, nobody is there. So this is from the same scene. I'm going to talk about this shot too, because this is a really interesting shot. So we've established this lexicon of the Steadicam point of view shot as the killer. Then we've kind of broken it a little bit, but here we're establishing something similar again. And this is the kind of shot that makes you feel as though you are looking from the voyeuristic point of view of someone, because you're seeing something you really shouldn't be seeing, which is this young woman in her underwear, in the mirror, kind of talking to herself, whatever. Like, this is a private moment. We know we're not supposed to be looking at it. But also look at the frame here. Like, there's this wooden, the frame of the image is like cut in half by this door frame. So it's like the camera is like a creepy person lurking behind a door frame looking, which creates this voyeuristic, uneasy, perverted sense of almost spying on this woman. And we've established that the person who is doing the killing in this movie, you know, like in the first scene where they walk in on those people making out, right? Creeps in moments like this, like in Halloween, right? So again, having a dialogue with Halloween. Now, this is where this gets really interesting. She hears something and she looks. The camera starts moving, then she looks away, right? But look, we're coming around the door frame now. Pay attention to the fact that when the camera moves around the door frame, the whole time, she's not looking. So conceivably, this could be POV from someone lurking behind the doorframe. She looks, she doesn't see anything. Then she starts futzing with the sink, and we're creeping up on her as she's futzing with the sink, right? But now what happens here? This is what makes this shot so interesting to me, is it really feels like we're creeping up on her, and we've established this language of the killer and the POV camera, creeping, creeping, creeping on her, but to upend our expectations, she looks basically right at us, the camera, the POV, and she doesn't see anything. So there's very clearly nobody there. So we establish in the first shot of this movie, in dialogue with Halloween, that when we get these shots, we are in the point of view of the killer. Then in this scene, we establish that that is not necessarily true. So what does that do? It makes the audience nervous. It creates anxiety and tension because something that we previously thought was a given and was true is not always true. So now we start to realize we never know whose perspective we're in. We don't really know what we're looking at or where anybody is. But remember, at the beginning of this scene, we saw footsteps creeping into this room. Now, we don't necessarily know that was the killer, but we know someone else is in there. And we know that she has not seen this other person. And we are locked into a POV that is moving through and only showing us certain things, right? So we're not getting like a master shot where we can see the whole room. So now we start to get nervous too. And this is, again, this is maybe not something that people are consciously thinking about when they're watching the movie. But this is what the filmmaker is subconsciously making your brain do while you're watching this film. You start to get nervous because as a human being, if you are in a POV shot, your instinct is to want to be able to look around. You know someone is in this room and you know it's probably not for a good reason, but you can't, you're locked into the prison of what the camera is looking at because you cannot escape that, right? So it's all of these, they're using all of these devices built around this notion of the POV camera to build tension and anxiety and fear for the audience because we've come to expect something from this type of shot that the movie is now telling us we cannot expect from this type of shot. And if we take it beyond that, if we can no longer expect the murderer is always the POV camera and that it's a subjective perspective from a person's point of view and we are moving with that person, then we have to doubt all of the conventions of the movie that we've started to get acclimated to. I think this shot comes about halfway through the movie. We start to, you doubt everything because you realize that the things you thought were true are not true. It's so smart and it's so well done. And it just, and this is the kind of movie where, you know, slasher movies, I think people tend to, and this is not true of, I'm a big fan of slasher movies. And I know that people who are a fan of slasher films and horror films, and like John Carpenter is an extremely well respected filmmaker. John Carpenter directed Halloween, and Sean Cunningham, who directed the Friday the 13th movies, obviously is a very intelligent and like kind of thoughtful filmmaker of this, the techniques that he's using here. But I think people tend to be kind of dismissive of slasher films, horror films, stuff like that, unless they are obviously well made, right? So like the Scream movies, because the dialogue and the concept is intellectual, people can get that and think, oh, this is a smart movie. What's really smart and extremely well done and like really high level craftsmanship about the Friday the 13th film is not incredibly obvious to like the average audience member. So these films tend not to get as much appreciation for how freaking well made they are. So I wanna show one more thing here from this same scene and then we'll be done with this video. So we've established that, okay, we don't know anything anymore. This is clearly not a POV shot, but there's someone in there. What is she looking at? Okay, now later in the same scene, this is so good. This is just a shot of her standing there. This is a very standard shot. This shot does not make us nervous. It almost seems like, okay, she's ready to leave the bathroom. She's done. She's peed. She's looked in the mirror or whatever. She's going to go back out to the party where people are hanging out or the person she's trying to get some nookie with. And And it's a very kind of standard shot that we don't fear because we haven't been trained over the course of this film to fear a very standard shot like this. But what I want you to pay attention to is the shadow behind her. Oh, what is that? That is an axe, my friend. So now we're really ripping up the book for what we expect from the language of cinema here, because instead of it being the POV shot or the person creeping from over here, whatever, this is just a very boring, banal shot, and the shadow is giving us the indication of what's to come. And she sees the axe, and I left this part out because we don't need to see her face getting hacked up. But if you want to see her face getting hacked up, I encourage you to watch Friday the 13th, which is an amazing movie, and Fiend Du Cinema. Anyway, my name is Will, and this was maybe last year or the year before. I watched Halloween, and then I watched Friday the 13th in like a week of one another, and I noticed that, and I was like, man, this is so smart. And I'm so happy I watched those films so close together because I was able to kind of pick up on that. So I thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoy this video. Let me know in the comments what you think about this, what your favorite slasher films are, other things of that nature, and we'll see you next time.